This video explains the internal working of the operational amplifier. The op-amp is a fundamental building block of analog electronics used in numerous applications. The key characteristic is its huge gain, which makes this device mostly used with a feedback. We see a basic op-amp in CMOS technology focusing on the gain and on the compensation capacitor. Op-amp is so named because it was developed to perform arithmetic operations, such as additions, subtractions, multiplications, divisions, and again logarithms, antilogs, integrations, and derivatives. Moreover, it is widely used for amplifiers, buffers, comparators, filters, which can be implemented with simple external circuits. An operational amplifier is an integrated circuit that amplifies the difference in voltage between two inputs. An op-amp has five terminals, two differential inputs and output, and two supply terminals. Generally, the gain is so high that you cannot use the op-amp without a feedback. Otherwise, the output would be saturated to a voltage level close to that of the supply. For this reason, we use a negative feedback even when we want just an amplification. Let's see how it works. A part of the output voltage is fed back into the inverting input, so the differential input is now Vin minus R1 over R1 plus R2 times Vout. This differential input times the open loop gain gives the output voltage. We can rewrite the output voltage in this way and see that if the open loop gain is high, we get this result, which doesn't depend anymore on any op-amp parameters. This is important because the closed loop gain depends only on the external components. It doesn't depend on temperature or frequency, for example, but this is true as long as the open loop gain remains high. For example, if the open loop gain is 1000, R2 equals 10 kΩ and R1 equals 1 kΩ, we get an error of 1%. Assuming high the open loop gain means assuming the differential input voltage very small. If the open loop gain is infinite, so in ideal conditions, the differential input voltage is zero, thus making the voltage on the inverting input equal to that on the non-inverting one. If this is true, no current goes into the two inputs and an infinite input resistance is shown. Assuming true the ideal conditions, the gain can be very easily calculated because the input voltage drops entirely on the R1 resistor, so the output is this one here. How to build such a device? Well, having two differential inputs and a single output, the first thought goes to a differential pair with a current mirror, so with just an output. Here you see an ideal element, so we put a real source of current. This is a current mirror in which we add the resistor R to create this current. You see the current depends on power supply too much, and this is not good, but for our basic circuit we are fine. The mirror copies the current on this branch, creating the tail current we need for the differential pair. When a Vin is applied to the differential input, a current imbalance in the two branches is created, so that here we have a plus GM times Vin half. Also copied here by the current mirror, and here a lack of GM times Vin half. So in the end, a current of GM times Vin flows outside the differential pair. If we want to know the gain, we need the output resistance, which is RO4 parallel to 2RO2, because M2 is degenerated with the source resistance of M1. So the gain is more or less GM times the parallel of RO4 and RO2. Let's say something about device sizes. We want source current as small as possible to dissipate less, so we'll choose a larger resistor R. To scale the tail current up, we choose the ratio W over L of M5 k times that of M6, so M1 and M2 becomes k half W over L, because they carry half the current of M5. Anyway, for choosing W over L, we have some constraints. On one side, a high W over L improves the GM, but on the other side, large width and small length make the output resistances small. Moreover, large width and large length make the capacitances larger, thus affecting the speed of the circuit. This kind of choices always depend on what the circuit is used for. This circuit has a differential input and output and two supply terminals, so this could be our op-amp, but it has two main issues. First, a reasonable value of gain for this circuit could be 50. This gain is too low for an op-amp, and it could become even lower if we consider the load. The load would be parallel to the output resistance, and it would lower the gain. So, this circuit is not good for driving resistive loads, but only capacitive loads. If we want to drive resistive loads, we need an output stage to decouple the load from the gain stage, but first we need to increase the gain. We could improve the differential pair using a cascode, both in the input and the current mirror, or we could add another gain stage. If you want a high gain op-amp, you probably go for both of them. For the sake of simplicity, we just add another gain stage. In particular, we add a simple common source stage with MOSFET M10 for the biasing of the stage. Note that M7 has to be a PMOS, because an NMOS cannot be used for bias considerations. The gain of the first stage is preserved because from the output of the first stage we see the gate of M7, which has a very large resistance. The gain of the second stage is simply negative GM7 times the parallel of RO7 and RO10. And we assume it is more or less equal to negative 50. So the total gain is the product of the two gain stages, and it is about negative 2500. In order to have a positive gain, we can swap the positive input with the negative one. Unfortunately, we still have a problem in driving a resistive load. To solve the load issue, we use a class AB output stage. M8 and M9 are in transdiode configuration, and we need them to bias M11 and M12 and cancel out the crossover issue. The output resistance of the second stage is more or less unchanged because M8 and M9 are in series with M10, but their resistances are very small compared to that of M10. The output resistance of a transdiode configuration is 1 over GM, looking both into the drain and into the source. Now we have decoupled the gain from the load, and we can drive a resistive load providing it current, having our op-amp a small output resistance of 1 over GM11 or GM12. The sizes of these two output MOSFETs are much larger than that of the others, because we want them providing large currents and small output resistances. So this is finally our op-amp. It is a very basic version, but it shows all the characteristics we were looking for. A high gain to keep the V- equal to V+, when there is a negative feedback, even if the gain in this case can be very much improved. A high input resistance and no current into the inputs, because inputs are connected to the gates of two MOSFETs. A small output resistance, because the output is driven by the sources of two large MOSFETs. It seems we are done, but we still have a problem. We said that we use the op-amp mostly with negative feedback. But for this to work properly and achieve stability in the feedback loop, another modification is needed. The op-amp has at least two poles, introducing phase shift and affecting stability. The negative feedback works as long as it remains negative. So, when we are able to feedback in the inverting input a positive signal, which then is subtracted from the input signal. But if the op-amp has a large phase shift, we risk to subtract from the inverting input an inverted signal, creating this way a positive feedback, which leads to instability. The first pole is created by the capacitances in this node here. The red capacitance C-gate drain 7 is amplified by the Miller effect coming from the gain of the second stage, so this is the pole with the lower frequency. The second pole is created by these other capacitances. Here you see the two poles characterizing the op-amp, and you see that the phase shift is near 180 degrees, which can be reached adding the delay of the feedback line or the load capacitance, thus creating a positive feedback and the instability. In order to prevent this, we had a compensation capacitor which shifts back the first pole, reducing the op-amp phase shift at 135 degrees and creating a safe phase margin of 45 degrees. Now, the unity gain occurs at a frequency smaller than before, let's say 1 MHz. So this is the compensation capacitor we put between the first and second stage, because we want to shift back the first pole. So this capacitor has to be large enough to become the dominant one, shifting the unity gain back at the frequency of 1 MHz. If we want to size this capacitor, we force the total gain equal to 1 at 1 MHz. And since this capacitor is the dominant one, its impedance is the only one we need to consider. So all the GMV in current flows through the compensation capacitor. So the total gain is now given by GM times the impedance, and this has to be equal to 1. So the compensation capacitor is this one here, and it can be, for example, about 10 picofarads. Please leave me a comment, let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.